Are you doing sales?
No.
Or militia?
Sorry.
Melissa, I did.
There was an article or something in the Atlanta Journal or something.
What is the deadline for this?
No, it's next week.
Okay.
So if she calls her like Monday, that would be okay.
I'll pass her over.
Yeah.
She was concerned that she did get left out loud.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that'd be okay.
Is it Res 4?
He's trying to go Res 4.
There we are. I told him.
Can't get anything to make sense otherwise.
They said, unless y'all spend too much time at the coffee shop.
Good morning.
How are you?
Oh, I know. I got your stuff ready. I didn't know where you wanted to see it.
Morning. How are you? Let's see. Do you have a list of who was covered? Should we wait on?
Tim and Joanne are the only ones that RSVP'd.
Okay.
You know, I'd be right. I forgot.
I know.
We need you to be here.
I'll always tell you I'm not coming.
All right, that'll be good. I'll just expect you to be here then. Yeah. All right.
So we don't know about Ben.
Of course.
Ben is out of town. Okay. And, we'll give him just a few minutes. So we should have plenty of time. Matter of fact, Randall. So we're ready. Yeah. We're good. And you got a copy of this.
Discounts. But most of it, as much as I love saving money,
not ready.
I do too.
But McDonald's, Seago gets a free cup of coffee or what?
No, I didn't know that.
Small.
Bobby, I was disappointed that you were not at the rubber meeting Monday morning.
I know, Melissa said, Terry sent word that you missed.
We sent word that we missed you, and you missed a good speaker, and Coach Dooley.
And I had some more important things to do.
I can't imagine what that could be.
Putting down my soft dollar.
I bought his gardening book. It's really pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think he sold a bunch of books.
Have you seen his backyard?
No, I'd love to see it back.
I guess he's doing better than
this. He's doing about me over, I have believed.
This son's got to be just sitting there.
I don't think Coach Dooley ever made the kind of money annually that Derek's making, but Derek's making short lived.
Derek's making short lived.
And I think he's a good coach and a good man. I think he got into a bad situation.
I don't think he did better. All these things are going on.
Joanne, if you need a rotary makeup, you're going to be busy today. Seth's going to talk about rotary club with some footage of his win in Indianapolis.
That should be a good program.
In car shot.
I saw that.
Big for celebration shots.
I don't know yet, man.
I read the article. Oh, you want to tell the rotary today?
We got the chamber next month.
Oh, shoot.
I think I better do something.
And 4 o'clock, University of North Georgia.
That's right.
Busy day for us.
I bet it is.
That's a good day for y'all.
It'll be a lot of stuff in the evening.
Y'all covered it, didn't we? I did well on the paper that week.
That wasn't me. I didn't read it. I'm kind of like,
you should have.
I think I'm sort of sucks. Although I kind of dismissed the deal from Bulldog. He's got a whole lot of life inside the Bulldog.
No. He had that little stick.
And he is an Auburn grad.
He
didn't actually go to Georgia.
Jim Huntley is working on getting, what's the Georgia Tech coach?
Oh, no.
To come speak to South, so we'll let y'all know it may be a joint meeting during the winter.
Yeah.
In off months. So he's working on that.
He's a better speaker than everybody thinks he is. He's got a really dry sense of humor. And he's really kind of, he did a Boy Scout thing 2 years ago and before that. He's really kind of a dry wit kind of guy, but he's not smooth at all.
That dude's dry.
Yeah, he's pretty much he's football.
I'm trying to look at it.
He's a nose game. That's what
I like. He's a dog. And he's been named in the
politician.
And I have been on the internet, and I have talked to breeders.
Paul don't get a breeder.
Is
he's going to have to offer a board at some point.
Well, as a matter of fact, I'm going to call. And he's an attorney, so I got his phone number at his office, and I'm going to give
him. Hey, look, that's
sure he'll take my phone.
I don't care. It's pretty
cool. Hey, look.
Doesn't really care.
If he can win, beat Jordan.
That's all. We'll pay him to win.
Was Randall going to be here today?
As far as I know, he was. Because he got a copy of the agenda and everything.
Well, he's going to be just put it down.
He asked to be on the agenda.
We don't have much of a meeting without him today. So,
this will present the bar.
That's not going to happen today.
Oh, well,
they're not prepared for that. So, we had to put it on there, but we postponed it last meeting.
Yes.
All right, so.
What's the hope there?
No. I think
it was set up yesterday. I looked at it.
They were applying for the building.
What's that?
What they're going to do is they're only going to take down enough of the bond for the.
What's the lady's name speaking today?
They're going to do the
same former newscaster.
At 11:30, I'll be on my calendar, but I don't know who. I don't remember.
So they're in the process of applying for building permits and get all that red tape.
Put it on my calendar, but I didn't.
And they wanted to do that before
NCR did that wrong earlier.
Yeah.
That's probably not bad plan. But they actually brought NCR bonds, so they're sponsoring today.
That's why.
Okay. You know how long that takes. They brought the speaker
to the permit.
That's actually pretty good.
First thing. So,
I can't remember either.
Particularly something's complicated. It's similar.
They said that lunch up for 250.
They're up for something there.
That may not arise. There was something that they had to do, not just apply.
Victoria Coggin. She's founder of Ladies Who Launch. It used to be Fox Leads, I think. Victoria Coggin. C-O-L-L-I-G-A-N.
We'll go ahead and call the meeting to order. Are you recording this, Angie?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. First thing, we always have a pledge allegiance to the flag, so if you'll stand and join me in the pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Okay. First item on the agenda is to approve the minutes of the previous meeting. Have all of you had a chance to look at those? If not, look them over and I'll await a motion that we approve, unless there's any questions.
So moved.
Second. Yeah, moving second that we approve the minutes as presented. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right, they are approved. Next item is the Secretary Treasurer's report.
Yes. Mr. Chairman, in our account, our operating account, we have $34,342.02. As far as the income for this year, we have had, of course, $250 application fee for the
I think that's for this one.
That was for this
on the agenda today, the Town Club Windermere.
Yeah, that was 3 months ago, and we had interest for 7262. Expenses for the year, Side County, coming from Side County, Chamber of Commerce, $2,050, and the flowers for Mr. Edwards. On page two is the economic development account. We have $15,192.25 in the account. The money derived from $15,000 from the Side County government through our economic initiative. The beginning balance on January 1st this year, we had $5,359.81 in the account, and we've had $6.31 in interest. Expenses for the year under our economic development program we had. So far, we've paid CoStar Group $683.70 for our subscription to the real estate services, and for the 2012 bio convention through July 31st, we have expensed $2,490 This month, we have another $5,100 and some change that I'll report at the next meeting as of the end of August. That is also associated with the projects. Again, we have $15,192.25 in the economic development account, and our operating account, $34,342.02. And the REBA Phoenix's account is still open. There have not been any transactions for several months. I think we were supposed to have one last month, Emory, and I don't know, something happened and it got delayed or whatever. So there's nothing to report with that account, but there should be some report coming soon.
Ethan is not here, but I think we've got the one that's pending that you're talking about is the last installment or payment on that Phoenix's?
Yes, that's my understanding. And it was going to happen 2 months ago, and then I don't know what happened there, but it's been delayed. So.
Okay. One comment I would make, Tim, because you had sent me some correspondence on that CoStar group, which is the funding for the database system on available properties. They are billing us for the county's participation in this.
There's quite a bit of confusion with the bill. CoStar. I've been on the phone, I don't know how many times, with the CoStar group in Washington, D.C. They split the billing up, and they're billing us for the chambers bill, which is, right. is correct. But they're also billing us for the Forsyth County Tax Assessor's Office.
Right.
And the way this came to my attention, I had a collector call me and tell me we were 3 months past due on paying our bill. I said, well, sir, I haven't received your bill. I'll be glad to pay. I'll overnight it to you if you just tell me what we owe. And then I got to checking on it, and come to find out we had two separate bills. One for the tax assessor's office and one for...
But they weren't both coming to us, were they? Or were they?
No, I changed the address on the one for the chamber to come to my attention to the bank.
Yeah.
And then somebody at CoStar changed it back and was sending it to our attorney's office. So I called it and had him to email me the bill so I could get it out this month. We're current on the chamber's bill, which is what we're responsible for. The tax assessor's bill, I really don't understand. I've gotten Doug involved, and he and Ms. Kirkpatrick are helping us with that.
I was going to ask if you talked to Mary about it.
Yeah, Mary is working on it also, and we'll get that rectified. It's my understanding that the company CoStar has set up two separate accounts, and there should just be one, and they split those off.
And you may want to talk to Mary about it. I'm going from memory. But what Mary said is we currently subscribe to some service with them. And she said, but we don't have enough to do all of this. But I'll be glad to put what I have in my budget toward that if you guys can. If I can tag on to what the chamber is doing, I'll put what I've got toward that. I don't know what that was.
And well,
the
way Mary and I left it, I just told her, you know, please tell me if I need to do anything else. But I know she is working through that. And again, I don't think it's the tax assessor's office for her, certainly not Mary's, but the CoStar group. But I think they wound up maybe with two different account officers that were handling two separate accounts, and they're both sending invoices. Well, one sending invoices to me and one sending them to the tax assessor's office.
Well, I guess the tax assessor already had a relationship with them for some of their services. This was enhancing their service, and basically what we had talked about is picking up that enhancement, and Mary was going to put whatever she had toward that. For what it's worth, about how we set the account up or who we pay or how we fund.
Who's negotiating? Who is our contact with CoStar? Do you do that?
We do, and well, Mary and I jointly, and we've been working with Frank Rizzo, and really it's just like Tim has said. I think internally at CoStar, they've just had some issues with trying to sort out really where things are supposed to be sent and then how things are supposed to be categorized. And they've been gracious, you know, in admitting that they've had some mistakes. Tim's been diligent working on making sure everything gets sent to the proper place. But right now, we're trying to rectify the final phase of that, which is getting everything sent to one location and one invoice, which was how we all agreed for it.
But this amount right here is just a change.
Just a change.
That's right. So there's another piece.
And I have just paid the August bill, and it was 650. So rather than, these numbers are month end as of July 31st. That'll be in the next month's meeting.
What we approved in the budget was about $1,200 a month for the total. Now, getting the bookkeeping and accounting, because what you're asked to pay is about half of that. So we've got it budgeted to do that. We just need to get the accounting straightened out and then get it.
They just need to consolidate those two accounts and send me one bill. I told the collector to call. It's kind of embarrassing. He called and said, 3 months past due. I said, sir, I just sent you a check for $2,000 for the coming South County Chamber of Commerce. He said, well, that's not the account I'm calling about. And I said, well, we must be talking about two different things. So that's kind of happened. The way I left it with him was, you know, we certainly want to honor whatever our agreement is, but well, we need to consolidate these two accounts and get the billing right, because it makes, you know, it makes all of us look bad. It doesn't matter whose fault it is.
Right. But I think it's up to them to get the billing.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Any other questions, sir, regarding the treasurer's report? If not, do I hear a motion to ratify the treasurer's report?
Motion.
We have a move and a second that we ratify the treasurer's report. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right, so ratified. Next item on the agenda is consideration of the bond resolution for Living-Towne Club Windermere Assisted Living LLC. They're not prepared at this time to move forward. They're still, I think, and Ethan, correct me if I'm wrong, but they have arranged their own separate financing to take down the property. And have taken it down? Is that?
No, at this point, I guess just for the record, remind everybody we're wearing a different hat. You know, we're not representing the
government. I understand. I'm just asking for
everybody. Just as an update from the applicant, they're arranging separate financing to take down the land, but they're still wanting to go through the development authority to for the construction loan.
Right.
So they are in the permitting process. They are working to get all of the preliminary requirements in order to purchase the land. So again, they appreciate the development authority's patience on this and requesting that y'all consider it your next meeting.
Right. You still feel confident in the project?
They are working very, very hard to make this go. So, yes, sir.
I think it just points out how lengthy and involved the process is or something like that. But anyway, they're not prepared today, and I think the best thing is just to postpone it until our next meeting, if we're in agreement with that. And if so, I'll entertain a motion and second.
Second.
We have a move and second that we postpone the consideration of this bond resolution until the next meeting of the development fund. Any discussion? All in favor of the postponement say aye.
Aye.
Okay. Motion is, or the consideration is postponed until the next meeting. All right, and that brings us to Randall. Randall is going to give us an overview today of the new Chamber's new economic website.
Yes, sir. And before diving into that, just wanted to make a quick announcement. Hot off the press, we've got our mid-year numbers just about how we're doing in terms of our recruitment and our expansion projects. Our confirmed expansion projects, we've had four this year, and all of these are actually international firms who have moved in previously that are now expanding. And out of all four, collectively, they're projected to generate from their expansions this year approximately 151 new jobs and $5.8 million in new capital investment, which is very significant. And in addition to that, we've also worked on a series of recruitment projects. And in total, there's five projects, the most recent of those being a company called Irvine Access Flooring that's recently moved their regional hub from Gwinnett County to Forsyth County because they felt they could experience significant tax savings. And in total, out of all of those firms, we've this year thus far generated approximately 168 new jobs and $10.7 million in new capital investment on improvement projects. So collectively, we're looking at nine projects in total that are forecasted to generate 319 new jobs and $16.5 million in new capital investment for the year. And for a mid-year number, that's significant. Normally, we start seeing more projects come in the fall, and that's just the ebb and flow that normally in the beginning of the year, we'll talk to prospects, and then they'll come back after the summer with their ideas about how they'd like to move forward, but it's really started a bit earlier this year. And I think a large part of that is because we're able to tap into those pipelines a little bit more earlier than normal. And part of that is due, you know, to an extent to what we're about to talk about now, our website. In the past, we've really had a challenge, I think, with shifting gears into the new method of how economic development projects are entering into communities. I think we've spoken about this before. 7 years ago, if a person was interested in learning more about Forsyth County, they would pick up the phone and they would call an economic developer and have a conversation about the community and the incentives that are available. Now that we live in the internet age, before a person typically even calls us, they're able to find information on us. And what's unique though is if we're not defining that data, then what they're finding are things that other people are saying about us. Fortunately for us, we're still one of the fastest growing and most affluent communities in Georgia, and we have a great story to tell, and other people have placed great information in the public realm about us. So it's positive. And when they call us, normally that's what they're saying. But we want to make sure that we can supplement a lot of that anecdotal information with hardcore data. And that brings us to our new website.
Randall, one question before we get that.
Yes,
just for information. How does Forsyth County, how do we stack up for the first 6 months this year? Building permits? And how does that compare to the counties around us with you better?
That's perfect timing. And honestly, that's one of the questions that we frequently get. When we do get a call, it's about specific data. And normally, we'll have to go and find that information. It's readily accessible, but we just haven't created a format for other people to experience it. So in reshaping our economic development website, and we'll just kind of walk through it, most of what you'll see when you click through it is just the general information that we've seen in the past. And we talked about how now there's some new headings under there, but the main thing I'd like to highlight is that there's a new page called Fastbacks. And if you click on that, it takes you to our map, our most recent community statistics, and then if we drop down a little bit, it'll talk about our top employers. But as we scroll down, what's unique is we started adding the most commonly requested questions that we'll receive. We'll add the answers here, so that way it's a quick and easy and readily accessible way to access data. Here you'll have our millage rates for our community and our surrounding communities, and that's as reported in the annual report. Our local colleges, our local airports, who are our local utility providers. But the key thing that we're often asked about are statistics pertaining to our community and then also pertaining to growth and residential and industrial development. If you take a look here under statistics and demographic data, we've developed two platforms. There's one heading here for the City of Cumming and the other for Forsyth County. Through our subscription to Nielsen's Claritas database, we're able to access both census data and micro-targeting estimate data that gives us the most accurate snapshot that they can present at that time of where we are in several different areas. And we'll start off, since we're in the county building, we'll talk a little bit about the county. It'll present, if I click on statistical analysis of Forsyth County, takes me automatically to a downloadable PDF. I'm sorry the window's so small here. But essentially it'll talk about our projections in terms of population out to 2017. and also talking about our growth patterns as measured by the census data from 1990 to 2000, then you see 2000 to 2012, then 2012 to 2017. But this report is actually about 12 pages. It gets very specific, provides a reader with demographic information about our population, breaks it down in terms of population by age, by sex, by ancestry. So if someone's interested in learning how many German-speaking citizens we have in our community, we were able now, with the click of a button, to get a direct access snapshot of what that number is. If someone wants to know how many people actually commute to work, we're often asked about our commuter numbers. We're able to provide that data in a real-time format, which is unique. Going back to the statistics page, and our chairman had asked a little bit about where's our real estate market at currently. In terms of real estate data, if you take a look, we have several headings here: our local market data, Metro Atlanta data, and then national market data. And if we start off kind of at the top for local market data, this is another benefit that we've received from the postcard package that we subscribe to. We're able to get, to the best of their ability, real-time snapshots of what the market is saying. So they'll keep track of the movement of property sales and then basically provide us with the real-time estimate of what the sales and vacancy rates are. So if we were to click on local office market and take a look at vacancy rates, and again, I'm sorry that this top half keeps popping up that way, but it gives you a breakdown of what the vacancy rates are for our community, and it measures it over time from 2009 up to the last quarter that they report on, and the new quarter numbers should be coming up soon. But what's key is we're able, again, at the click of a button, to take a look at what the average cost per year per square foot for offices are, based on what the current market rate is. And we're also able to take a look at seeing what the year-to-date numbers are and what the direct availability in terms of square feet for our entire community is. That's significant. That's something that really helps us to have a specific advantage in providing data as compared to our surrounding communities. Now, the other thing that this is able to do, if we go down just a little bit, and that information is also broken down in terms of office and industrial for our local, the metro area, and then in terms of national data. So that way, if someone wanted to compare apples to apples snapshot, they would be able to do so. But what we're often asked about was what the chairman asked about, which is our housing numbers. We are fortunate that the county has developed a platform where they can publish our housing and residential and industrial permit numbers publicly. And by linking our two web pages to one another, we're actually able to provide a direct access into those numbers. And this automatically updates every time that the county updates their website. So if you take a look, the far column here shows all the months that they're able to report on, and the last reportable month was in July. This column tells the number of single-family residential permits that were issued in that month. And as you can see, it gives the year-to-date number as those numbers add up each month. So right now, this past month, we actually had 152 single-family residential permits. It's down a little bit from June, which was 278, but overall, still a great number. 1,309 permits overall. And we can track that for multifamily residential, commercial, and then also mobile homes. So oddly enough, through the county's progressive idea of really being proactive and publishing that data online, we're now able to connect directly to them and create a reciprocal link, which is outstanding.
Does this information tell us how that compared last year? This, or any of our other counties, or not, do you know?
This does not, and we do have that data, but we found out it's actually more beneficial for us to keep that data in the office to prompt someone to make a phone call to us, and that gets the dialogue going. Usually, we're able then to start figuring out why they're looking for the information, what other info they might need. But we do have it. And the other unique thing I think that's worth mentioning, excuse me, if we scroll all the way down, we get several questions about workforce issues. Throughout the country, it seems there's a void of technically trained workers. And because of that, many people, when they're looking to locate their industrial facilities, often ask us about the extent to which we're able to supply technically trained workers. Fortunately for us, we have great partners with Lanier Technical College, the University of North Georgia, as well as, excuse me, as well as working with our partners with our local school system in the STEM Academy. And we're able now, through a unique partnership with the Department of Labor, to provide weekly wage data to demonstrate the extent to which we're able to offer employees, but also to talk about how we're able to offer them at a competitive rate. And again, sorry about the kind of length of the window there. Take a look, what this chart's showing is basically the average weekly wages of employees within the technical engineering field. So your folks who would actually work the gears and work on the floor of the factory. And then it shows those tracked over time. And then it provides a person with basically the quarterly numbers and the annual numbers. And then it gives a preliminary estimate about what that might be if they moved to our community. And we're able to do that on several different job sectors. There's different outputs that the Bureau of Labor Statistics has in terms of manufacturing versus engineering. So what we were able to do in partnership with the Department of Labor was quite simply access all of them and then list them publicly on our website. So now, more or less, if there's anything that a company wants to learn, we have the ability to refer them to this website, and we also can use it as a tool for ourselves as we seek data. And then we're also able to talk a little bit about incentives. And that was the other thing I wanted to kind of walk through very quickly before wrapping up. Our incentive package is very unique in Forsyth County. Before any business even begins to look at what our incentives are, most businesses that we've spoken to, even about our property tax abatement program with the Development Authority, are interested in the fact that our taxes are relatively low. I think on average, they're able to save, or our millage rates are roughly 16% lower than those of our surrounding communities on average. What's also beneficial is that there are many communities throughout Metro Atlanta that have chosen to raise their millage rates over the last year in order to make up for economic shortfalls. However, Forsyth County is remaining relatively low. So with that being the case, we decided to create an incentives portal that allows for a business to take a look at what we're capable of providing them. And it gives a quick snapshot of our tax credits, tax exemptions, we've got our Freeport exemption there, our property tax abatements, and then it also links to some of both the national, the state, and the local resources in different areas. And that's something that we've heard a lot from companies. The state of Georgia might have a shortfall with offering, for example, incentives to businesses that have less than 25 employees. However, there are some federal programs that are able to offset that. And one thing we mentioned last year when we did our inventory analysis of our incentives was that it would be beneficial for us to really start figuring out how can we co-mingle and partner different programs to provide a stronger package. And what we're able to demonstrate here is that even from the financial standpoint, anything from angel investor tax credits to the state of Georgia's financing programs, all the way to green incentives like lighting and utility upgrades, there's direct access to them. And then after each program's listed, we give a quick breakdown, a snapshot that someone can print off if they have some questions about each program, and then take that back and take a look at what the uses are for each program as well. Property tax abatements, we have our program featured there, but as you notice, we kept each overview limited to about 2 to 3 sentences. And again, that was done purposely so that way, if a company is truly interested in learning more information, it prompts them to contact us directly.
Do our surrounding counties have the same information online available?
They do, but not to this extent. One thing that we heard kind of in our small little focus group when we were talking to companies was that most of the companies are really, they find it challenging to navigate these kinds of websites because they're not typically user-friendly. It's more of a basis of tax code and less of just an overview of what the incentive can really do for the company. So we took that feedback to heart, and rather than, for example, placing the job tax credit information here and then listing what that actual code is and then putting the official code of Georgia reference below it. We quite simply just took the general verbiage of what the tax credit can do for a company and provided that there, and then created a link. And again, once you click on each link, it'll forward you directly over to the corresponding agency and then their general overview, not the tax code, but their general overview about what that program is, which is much more beneficial than having a technical web page that provides the specific analysis.
Well, and my point of that was, if we're advertising what our incentives are, all of our competing counties know what we're doing. Do we know what they're doing?
Oh, yes, sir.
Okay. All right.
And if we go back very quickly, one other thing we want to take a look at were two things: what workforce development incentives were available publicly, and then what green incentives were we able to offer. In terms of workforce development, it seems as though training becomes one of the key factors when a business moves into the community. Overall, the Chamber of Commerce and the Development Authority have worked very diligently to make sure that we're accessing most of the resource providers who are able to offer workforce development and training programs. And because of that, most of the providers were gracious enough, including Lanier Tech, to grant us with information to list here. In terms of our overview, it's interesting. We're able to offer everything from the complimentary access for screening eligible candidates all the way down to complimentary training programs through the Quick Start curriculum. And then also skills assessments and then retraining tax credits. All of those are typically listed on separate web pages and separate documents, but for the purposes of workforce development, we combine all of those into one website here, where you can access everything from the Georgia Works program all the way down to the new Vow to Hire Veterans program, which provides up to $4,000 in tax credits for folks who hire veterans to work. So this is a unique resource. And the other one was the Green Incentives initiatives. There's actually a sustainable toolkit that the Department of Natural Resources has created. And it was developed because there are a lot of companies who hear about going green, they know it's a trend, they know it's catchy, but they're not exactly sure what it means. And we thought that was a fantastic thing to feature on the website, to create essentially a guide that would allow for companies to figure out strategies where they could actually develop step-by-step examples of saving energy and developing sustainable practices within their organizations. And then on the resource side, you actually have real-time examples and videos that can demonstrate what that has meant to other companies who have already implemented those initiatives. Now, the reason that's significant is because many of our international companies are already familiar with going green and with energy efficiency and sustainability. And when we speak to them, what's most important in their minds is that, not that a community understands these issues, but that they have them in practice and that they're willing to help other companies share that same mindset. So this has been a tremendous resource with our outreach to international firms. In addition to that, the Green Incentives page also talks about some of the property tax abatement programs that we're able to offer through the Development Authority, and then some of the green energy programs that our utility providers offer. So all in all, we've developed a website that we feel is pretty comprehensive. In prior meetings, we've already covered the issue about the available properties, but just very quickly, we have our map here of all of our existing business parks, and then we have a clickable directory of the properties that are on the market at the moment, and that's provided through CoStar. So this is where the CoStar link goes directly to. And here you see we have our industrial properties listed, and then we've categorized our land properties from those 100 acres and above, and basically 0 to 99 acres, or 1 acre rather. And then available office space products. And retail is something we'll talk about a little bit later, but our retail properties we list there as well, because we're starting to see tremendous movement in the retail sector with Academy Sports coming in last year, Mellow Mushroom, and then also Carrabba's just getting ready to open on the 20th. And then our opportunity zone. We made sure we gave an overview of the opportunity zone, and again, that's a link that goes directly over to the county's website and talks about the tax credits that the opportunity zone offers. But that's also coupled with all of the properties. Again, sorry about the window,
but all the properties that are located within the Opportunity Zone itself. On each property, you'll see the properties, a picture of the property's key stats in terms of taxes, square footage, and cost per square foot. And then you'll also see who to contact and whether or not that property is for sale. And that's for all the properties listed above, same type of thing. You'll get that same info once you click through it. And then we have a small feature here for executive office suites, and that's key again for our international firms who are looking to move in. They want to start off very small, but as you can see through the expansion numbers we mentioned earlier, they grow very quickly, much more exponentially than our domestic companies. But that, all in all, is our new platform, and our goal is really to develop it and keep growing it, and I'd like to invite y'all to take a look at it when you get a chance, and just feel free to offer any input about tweaks we can make and different ways we can enhance it. As we look to grow this, I think it'll play a critical role in helping us to generate new jobs and capital investment.
How long has this been up and running?
We put kind of a, I guess, a beta version. I learned that from our interns. We put a beta version up about a month ago prior to going to the bio conference. That way, as Lynn and I were talking to companies, we would be able to access the data right from our iPad while we were there. After that, we really enhanced it and put much more features. One thing we didn't talk a little bit about was our small business services. If a company is looking to develop a business plan or to grow their company, there's real-time examples and templates on how to develop a financial plan, a marketing strategy, the overall business plan itself, with videos that also link to step-by-step guides that will walk you through the process. And we also have a partnership with a reference and marketing database called A to Z, which is significant because it provides data that businesses can use to develop that business plan. And all of these resources, I think, are combining to allow for us to be at the forefront of economic development in our region. And as we've always said, we're a nationally ranked community. And because of that, we're receiving a lot more inquiries, I think, than many others. So this has played a key role in helping us to provide the level of data, I think, that those folks who are making the inquiries are expecting to see.
Good report.
Yeah,
that's
really good. It looks like a very user-friendly website. I think we get a lot of benefit out of that, hopefully.
Thank you.
Good job.
Yeah,
Randall, while you got the floor, I was going to ask, and I didn't get a chance to talk to you prior to the meeting, but do we have a conference or a convention coming up that we need to talk about attending? Or
yes, sir.
Could you update us on that?
Very much. On September 11th through the 14th of this year, the Georgia Economic Developers Association is going to host their annual conference, and this year it'll be in Savannah, Georgia at the Hyatt Hotel on Bay Street. Purpose of the conference is a twofold matter. First, it serves as an opportunity for economic developers to access direct training and networking with one another. But secondly, this is the primary conference that the project managers who handle recruitment for specific industry sectors who work at our utility companies and at the state's economic development department. This is the primary conference that they attend. And it's rare to get that group in mass, so it's key to make sure we have a presence there. Want to ask the Development Authority, I know we have it in our work plan and the budget to attend, but there's an opportunity for a sponsorship for the new members that are actually joining the organization there. I believe the sponsorship is $750, which is well below, I believe, what we might have budgeted for it. But I wanted to ask if the board was comfortable with sponsoring that headline. And the reason I ask, it gives some direct exposure, and it's actually a luncheon on the first day of the conference. And that might provide us with an opportunity to toot our own horn a little bit.
You'll get an opportunity to speak?
Yes, sir.
Who's planning on attending at this point? Do you know?
In terms of speakers?
I'm talking about, you know, from the Development Authority and or the Chamber?
From the Chamber, I was designated as the appointee to attend. I believe that that would make sense. And then from the board, I'd love to open it up if anyone was interested.
Well, that's why I was going to bring it up, to see if anybody could and desired to attend. Of course, we have two members that are not here, but I guess I'd leave it because we had budgeted, and I don't know how many people we budgeted, but we had that on our budget. If any of the Development Authority members want to go and can attend at that time, I'm just going to say get in touch with Randall and work it out.
Sorry. And that's a Tuesday through Friday, right?
Yes, sir.
That to have a golf tournament.
Do they have a golf tournament?
Yes. They do, yes, sir.
Of course they do.
Why didn't you say that to me?
I know that.
And the golf tournament is at the Westin Hotel and Resort. That's across the river.
Of course it is.
Randall, we had, not getting too much away from that, but while we're talking about it, we had budgeted also a couple of red carpet tours for some folks.
Yes.
And I know in the past, sometimes from, I guess, the same convention you're talking about, they have some red carpet tours that develop while the people are here after the fact or before the fact.
Yes, sir.
Do you know if that is in place this year?
In anticipation for that fact, we decided to designate September 21st as a red carpet tour day that will allow for us to do several things. First, it will provide us with an opportunity to get some of the recruiters who are working on bringing companies to Georgia into Forsyth County. In addition, it will allow for those recruiters to meet with the leaders and decision makers of some of our top companies. Or larger employers, I should say. After that, it'll allow for us to make sure they get access to information about our community and the leadership within our community. We're working on putting together a timeline for that. The rough itinerary is that we'll meet, Hans Groa and Siemens have both volunteered to serve as kind of host sites during the day. We're working out the possibility of maybe doing a workforce development style lunch. We recently did a similar tour for our international companies in partnership with Lanier Tech, and I think that went, the format went well, and we might be able to piggyback off that again. But probably our rough timeline is to start it at 10 a.m. Tour different businesses. Break for lunch, and during lunch talk about our incentives and workforce development resources, and then after lunch move forward with actually having kind of a host session where we can take folks out on the lake and let them meet our community leaders. And I think that'll give a pretty comprehensive overview of our community, our local flair, and what we're able to offer.
And who is this being sponsored by or put on by? Is that through the Georgia Economic Development Department, or?
This would be through locally.
We will be hosting these.
Yes.
Okay.
And
I know in times past they put together one that goes through several different counties and they stop over here.
Yes.
That's not what we're talking about.
The red carpet tour that the state of Georgia offers, the previous one that they had, unfortunately it didn't stop in Forsyth County, and we were gracious enough to call the state and remind them about the fact that we're ranked as one of the fastest growing communities in America. And because of that, they were kind enough to offer several seats to us for our local companies that we're working on helping out with expansions. And it benefited us pretty significantly. One of them is Project Converting. I think y'all have seen the data on that one. It's the local company from overseas that works on developing converting materials for tissue. And they're working on an expansion project. That allowed for us to get that particular CEO one-on-one time with the governor, which played a huge role in us moving forward. But unfortunately this year, they I guess they kind of forgot about us. But they remember us now, so that's good. But this will give us the opportunity to do one locally, and we appreciate the Development Authority help and support on that. I should have a rough timeline really by next week that I can send out to everybody.
Yeah, if you would circulate that to everybody so we'll know what the schedule is, if anybody can participate in that.
Yes, sir.
To get alcohol to board there.
And we can do a registration page through the website in case y'all know any resource providers or any realtors you think that might want to join in on the red carpet tools. But
what was the date?
September 21st, and the ballpark time is between 10 and 6 p.m. On the 21st.
Well, just in talking about companies today, NCR Silver is sponsoring the Expo Line.
Yes, sir.
Tell me who NCR Silver is. What's their relationship to NCR?
Same company. NCR Silver is a new product that they're moving forward with that will help small to medium-sized businesses with processing data internally. You might remember Radiant Systems was a company that was homegrown here in Forsyth. They were recently acquired by NCR. And that's kind of how the partnership started there with NCR. They're hosting a complimentary lunch today as part of the Business Expo to kick it off. I believe that starts right around 11:30, 12 o'clock. Shortly after that, the Expo floor will open up. We've got roughly 65 companies represented this year, which is phenomenal. And it's within the Forsyth Conference Center, which is right here in Cone.
And is NCR Silver, what's their presence in Forsyth?
They actually are looking to develop that, okay. Which is part of the reason they want to
That's why they
use the Expo as a resource. And also, it's worth mentioning the today as well is the opening for the new University 400 campus, which is located right adjacent to the Aquatic Center. And I believe they're having their ribbon cutting this afternoon as well.
4 o'clock.
At 4 o'clock.
That seemed to happen pretty fast. I mean,
it did happen fast.
They waste any time once they got started.
They've exceeded their students that they had projected. They've got 500 students to start classes next week there. So
wow.
They were planning for 250, or that was their projection, but they exceeded that.
I'd say 500, they expected 250.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I said they see this very well.
250, but
that's great.
Mm-hmm.
I think they'll find that there was a real need for that service here, and it'll be, mm-hmm. I won't say overwhelmed, but I think they'll get very good response.
I think so,
obviously.
So,
twice
I'm anticipating looking at the building. Be nice having a tour to get.
That's great.
It was built with a good bit of value engineering added to it, but it was a $7 million project, so really, they got a lot of good value.
How was that funded? Where did the $7 million come from?
Part of it was from the state, part was from the foundation, which is College and State University Foundation, and Bobby, I'm not sure the rest.
Who actually owns the facility? North Georgia College or University?
Mm-hmm. Isn't that your understanding, Randall? It's owned by the university.
Yes.
The building's owned by the university. Mm-hmm.
With gracious Good. Support from the city.
Good. All right. That's all we have on the agenda. I have nothing else to bring up. Does anybody have anything that we need to discuss or talk about today before we adjourn? If not, I hear a motion, we adjourn.
Mm-hmm.
Move and second, we adjourn. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. Meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.
got somewhere on time.
I let her out of this meeting early, so she goes up to the top of the old house.
Really?
Yeah, there's still like 30 mechanical engineers. It's the American section. The American section of mechanical engineers. To talk about mechanical engineering and what's needed. So we're talking to him that changed. So theirs is more of a transfer for engineering program, and ours is engineering. Both of them will transfer to Southern Poly, but it's concentrated more in engineering here because we think some people won't transfer. Some people will just want to get that associate degree and go to work.
Right with it,
yeah. Yeah, and so my concern was if they graduate,
I try not to pull my
you got a different point. And we're calling them all engineers. Does that make sense?
Yep.
Yeah, so I'm trying to figure out which one is Shirley Nick. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Good job.
They're great to get all together. Thanks for having us. Good presentation.
They have a category for that.
And then one that says those with four conditions.
We'll look and see if that adds on the next time. He asked about the Hansen cards.
They may have it in their contracts, I don't know, but it's automatic, so they have some. appreciate
We did most of the celebrating over the on Friday.
That's the
before my birthday.
Let me know too. And Keith, I just told Keith that.
You don't run up by this one?
We're going to the W.
Okay, well, we're not.
Well, I'm not running.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
I guess I'm right. Thank you.
All right.
Great presentation.
You are probably getting bored of seeing me do like the same, because you get to hear it kind of in different ways each time, I guess.
But you do a nice job, a nice presentation, and I learn something every time.
Well, thank you. That's the big part. That's good to hear.
Good.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.